you don't know, Joy and Dennis lost everything in the Sonoma County fires. And Joy's been taking a few weeks off to gather her life together again. And we're thrilled that she's back.
Thank you, everyone.
Amen.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Well, you might have noticed that we have moved from Blessed to Me to a new sermon series. And so things are a little different as far as our order of service. And things are going to be a little different as the day proceeds. I'd like to take just a minute to tell you how a few things are going to work. When you come up for communion, the ushers will have a basket. You can just drop your offering in at that time. We're not going to have a separate offering time today. And we're going to have one station for communion in the center, so just come up in single file and have communion. Tyree and I will be serving this morning. The Chinese won't be coming in this morning for communion. And there are gluten-free wafers. If you need them, just let us know. We'll grab those and give those to you instead of the bread. Sandy Harden made our bread, but she's home with Faith, who's feeling well this morning. So Bruce brought it in. Thank you. Also, before we go on, I just want to take 1 second to thank the few people that created this beautiful scene for us for our series. It's a beautiful. And a lot of hours and effort went into it, so thank you so much for being a part of that sacred art ministry, I guess you'd call it, sacred space. They create these spaces for us that allow us to encounter God. It's a gift that we all enjoy. So, hope is when you stand in the dark and look out to the light. That's a line that I heard from a Hallmark movie last night. I thought it was a great way to start a sermon on hope. So we begin this Advent and Christmas series today called Angels Among Us. And we're going to be talking about how we might be messengers of hope to those around us. And to also be aware when people are bringing messages of hope to us. Advent is known as a season of waiting. Us know that, waiting for the Christ child to be born new in our hearts, for God to create the new heaven and new earth, and for Christ to come again and the reign of God to enter into our world. But waiting can also be a little problematic because, as Rhonda Britton wrote in her book, Fearless Living, when we passively wait, we are living in fear. So she's talking about when we wait for these circumstances outside of ourselves to change the way we feel, to help us, when we're waiting for something else to make us feel hope or peace or joy or love or new life. And when we do that, when we just wait for that to happen to us rather than take a part in it, then we rob ourselves of the chance to enjoy those things, to live out those things right now, cultivating those things means that we accept and claim our agency to make our lives our own and to move freely into the future, no matter what the circumstances of our lives or the world around us. And when we do that, then we're not living fully into what God has intended for us, because God gives us the power to make a difference, to help shift circumstances rather than live in fear. So the waiting in Advent can't be passive waiting. The kind of waiting that believes that God doesn't need us, right, in order to make the world a safer and better place for all people. We can't just pray in the morning for God to fix everything, and then we go out and go through our day as if we have no responsibility in making that happen. So this is the message that the angels who appeared to Zechariah and Mary and Joseph and the shepherds bring to us during this Advent season. Those are the things we're going to be talking about. They do bring news, yes, but they also invite participation in the story. The message is, you know, God is doing this, and you need to do this. You need to be a part of it. So get over your fear, because God is in need of you. And in order for all this to happen, then we're going to need more hope and more peace and more joy and more love and more light all around. God needs us to spread that word. So to use the story of angels can also be kind of dangerous. fall into that easy Hallmark card version, you know, which is, it's actually also the medieval Christian version of angels. Those kind of cute, round-faced, pink-cheeked cherubs, you know, with bows and arrows who are going to shoot you with the arrow of love. But angels in scriptures, to the contrary, seem to elicit anything but, you know, cute reactions. There was a reason why the first thing angels always said was, do not be afraid. Because their appearance must have been surprising at best and downright scary at worst, right? But they were also a wake-up call. They came with these life-altering messages. I mean, if you saw an angel standing in your room, look out, your life is going to get real different real fast. So I think this do not be afraid message was both imminent in that, you know, quit shaking in your boots right now, but also don't be afraid to do what I'm about to ask you to do. Don't be afraid to live into what God is calling you to. The English word angel comes from a Latin word, angelus. I don't know who speaks Latin. I know someone who speaks Latin. Is it angelus, angelus? I don't know. Derived from a Greek translation. But anyway, the original term was all about function. So it was about the function of a messenger. Angels were messengers. And then, over time, angel came to signify the name for a class of beings kind of existing between God and humanity. And so then a whole lot of kind of angelology came about, with theological speculation through the ages. Certainly, that continues in popular notions about angels today. But this series that we're about to begin, that we are beginning, we're going to be talking about the original meaning, a messenger, an envoy of one, or one that announces, the messenger announces. And angels are the symbols of messages that we need to hear, that we need to wake up to. And we use the word that we've come to, or the words that we've associated with our Advent time of Advent before Christmas, right? Hope, peace, joy, love. Those are our four candles in the Advent wreath, and each week usually is devoted to those four things. And so we're going to be talking about angels in relationship to those things. The idea is that by taking in and taking on the message, we become the angels among us, getting the message out to all of those within our sphere of influence. We're the ones that can do that, and we're the ones that need to be the messenger. So Britt goes on to say in her Fearless Living book that fear, get this, because this is important, fear is the gatekeeper of your comfort zone. Fear is the gatekeeper of your comfort zone. That makes a lot of sense to me, right? We don't leave our comfort zones because we're afraid of having our lives be too different, or being invited to be somebody sort of unfamiliar to ourselves, or to step into a duty that we are unfamiliar with or don't believe we have the gifts for. We live in a time, as we know, where we're exposed to so much information that causes fear and anxiety. Anybody who walks out of their house and isn't a little bit afraid right now has not been watching the news. And so in that time, we need to fly in the face of fear by putting out information that's counteracted through these pervasive messages of fear. How do we interact with fear? We have to counteract fear by having messages that are positive, that are full of hope. I thought one thing we could do during this Christmas season is to offer positive messages wherever we go. I don't know if you use Facebook or Twitter or Instagram or any of those, but if you do, how about I'm going to challenge you to put up a message of hope every day this week and hashtag it. I'll tell you about that in a minute if you don't know. Hashtag it with more hope. So if you haven't used a hashtag before, you just put the number sign and the words more hope, no spaces, no capitals. And by doing that, everybody who's a part of that conversation, who's hashtagging with more hope, those conversations will be seen together and you'll be able to navigate them. Now, if I'm speaking Greek to you, don't worry, don't do that. But you can still offer messages of hope to those around you. Send a card, make a meal, do something nice. Try to think of some way you can offer a hopeful message this week. So in our scripture reading this morning, that was so beautifully done by our choir, and Tyree, thank you. They talked about this kind of, you know, just, it wasn't really just another day for Zechariah, because he kind of won this great opportunity to go into the Holy of Holies, right? Take care of the altar, make sure that things were done properly and in good order. And when he gets in there, there's an angel at the altar, which I'm sure gave him a pause. And here he is, you know, of course, I don't know why he got in trouble for questioning the angel myself. I mean, it seems to me, if an angel told me that I was going to have a baby at whatever age this woman was, 90s, let's say, I would not only be afraid, I would probably start knocking my head against the wall. But they wanted this, though, so it's okay. I've done my part. But Zechariah questioned the angel, and for questioning the angel, he was silenced right until the baby was named. But I wonder about times in our life when something happened after which we knew nothing else would ever be the same again. And I know that that would be an automatic thing in loss or grief. But sometimes it's also life-altering in a positive and happy way. Something happens, you get a scholarship to the school you always wanted to go to. I don't know. You can imagine your own thing, after which your life will never be the same again. And so I think in the midst of this great change, hope is a very welcome thing, because change is scary. So Advent can remind us that God makes us ready for whatever unknown thing may come our way, and calls us to be messengers of more hope in an ever-changing world. Fear is said to be the opposite of hope. I think of despair as the opposite of hope, because I think when you're in a state of despair, it's very hard to see the light. It's hard to see the next turn. It's hard to think that things can be a different way. And so it's a state in which you may be standing in the darkness and not able to look into the light. The message to Zechariah and Elizabeth will bear a son in their old age. And this son, remember, is going to be the messenger for the one who will save all people. And it's a story of it's an unexpected story of hope and the call to be something different, to raise a child who is going to announce the coming of the Savior of the world, and to walk into that with hope, with trust, with faith. I mean, Zechariah is like, but I'm old. And Gabriel says, but I'm Gabriel. I mean, who's going to argue with that, right? God must get frustrated with all of our buts and excuses and questioning and cynicism when God tries to break in, right? Even when it's good news. So the angel's appearance throughout Luke is the breaking in of the divine into ordinary life. That's the theme of all of Luke, is God breaking into the ordinary lives of people. And the appearance of an angel in the first chapter signals that this is an extraordinary story of divine events, but it's going to take place in the middle of ordinary lives, ordinary people living their ordinary lives. The message here is that one person can and does make a difference, no matter how insignificant the contribution might seem to you. God is calling us to become a people ready to be messengers of hope through our words and actions. But not just messengers. Sometimes we have to be open to being the receiver of hope. Sometimes Sometimes we are in despair. Being Christian doesn't make us hunky-dory in life, right? Everything still happens to us the way it happens to everybody else. Houses burn down. Lives start over. People get sick. People lose jobs. We know what it is to live in despair. And so being sensitive and kind and aware, not only of one another in our church, but all of those outside. You know, it's easy. We kind of do it together. We love each other. We take care of each other. We listen to each other's problems. It's what we do in the church. But sometimes when we get outside and someone's got different opinions than we do, and they start talking at us and how they're all right and we're all wrong, and it's really hard to throw out a message of hope to them. But that's what we're called to do. We're called to step it up. And if we don't do it, who's going to do it, right? Mm-hmm. And in this culture, this atmosphere that we live in, of such haste and anger and, you know, fighting and violence, we need to be a loud message of hope.
Yeah.
So be hope, or seek hope, and allow God in. Allow God a voice in your life. And when needed, be that voice for others. Francis of Assisi, you might remember this. It's my signature in my email, but it's something like, live the gospel, and when necessary, use words.
Mm.
So that's what we need to do. And I think this is a time for words. We've been silent for a long time, kind of saying, well, we live good lives and we're good examples, but you know what? It hasn't been enough. We need to put it out there, guys. We need to put out our messages of hope and love and joy and life. So today we're talking about hope. I invite you to spread hope this week in whatever way you can. And remember that hope is a powerful thing. Martin Luther King said, we must accept finite disappointment, but we must never lose infinite hope. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.